That's not my grandma.
No. Good evening. It's good to see you all here in person. I see there's about six or so, it says, on the live stream. So we're glad to have you all there. We are watching it, and if anything happens, just please be patient with us, and we'll get that back on as soon as we can. As far as tonight goes, we have several announcements, several things going on the week of the 13th and 14th, but just things we want to make you aware of. Last week was the 4-H car wash. It was scheduled then, but it got delayed to this. It got delayed to this Saturday. I have the image of that, so if you need the location, talk to me and I can get that to you. And I could also tell you the time. The flyer has that time on there. But it is in Thornville. It's at a hardware store. Is that right?
Yeah, it's at the Thornville Hardware Store.
Okay. Thornville Hardware Store, 9 to noon or something?
9 to 3.
3,
it's
okay.
It's at the corner of 13 and Boundaries.
Okay.
Where Tri-County Plumbing used to be.
Yeah, used to be Tri-County Plumbing, now it's...
Behind Lake City.
The car wash, guys.
Well, there you go. You shouldn't have any more questions. As we discussed Sunday evening, May 14th, the young adults are going to get together. They're going to go to the hills, to their house at 5 o'clock. So we look forward to that. Then we have a flyer in the back for May 13th and 14th. There's a men's retreat at Fort Hill, if you're interested in that. And then there's also May 14th at Midwestern, a 5K that is taking place. So those are just some of the things. There is a flyer in the back about that as well. May 21st, we plan on having a youth devo, having a youth movie night, which we will either go to Lancaster to the drive-in, or we will go to the theater. Just depends on what's showing and timing. We don't want to have everyone out too late. But that'll be May 21st. Then on the 22nd is when we're having the outside evening song service. It's the fourth Sunday of the month. So we'll have a song service outside, and after the service, we'll have an ice cream social. There's a sign-up sheet on the back for flavors of ice cream and toppings. And so if there's something you'd like to bring that's not ordered on the sign-up sheet, please be aware of that. Then May 17th, I jumped that day, but May 17th, the parking lot is being paved. That's a Tuesday night. And they said everything should be good by Wednesday when we meet for services. So May 17th and 18th, just be cautious. Don't be driving on the parking lot those days until we come for Wednesday night service on the 18th. Then on the 27th, Carla had messaged me. That's all right. That's Cameron. On May 27th, Carla had messaged me. Avery is having a graduation party with a friend of hers, and it's at Connection West, which is, again, Lancaster, we're going to put that in the bulletin, so that way you have the time, and if you need the specific address, we can do that, but that's a Friday. Then I was talking to the Dorse Sunday, and I do believe they say that Kirsten graduates May 29th. I didn't hear a time, but that is Sunday. That's the Sunday we plan on having the potluck, so that kind of works out well if you'd like to go and congratulate her. That'll be 29th after our potluck, after we have that afternoon service. We also want to make people aware that that's the day we'll have cupcakes and a spot if you would like to give the graduates a card. We'll have that in the back on the 29th, that Sunday morning.
Did you say a card or a car?
Well, what would you like to give? I know one of them has a car, but they wouldn't turn it around or turn it away. Yeah, help pay for college, so that's all right. But yes, a car, May 29th. Then we also have June 5th is the lock-in here, so we're planning on that. And then on June 4th and the 5th, Pickerington, Church of Christ, they're doing a VBS for In the Beginning. So there's a flyer here. We'll post it in the back. But it has, on the 4th, they start from 10 a.m., go to 2:30. And then on the 5th, they'll go from 5 to 7. So that would be, that'd be a Saturday, Sunday. But it also got a spot, it looks like, to register or volunteer. So if you'd like to help out with that. And they are doing children through 5th grade. So, and then they have a contact down here. So we'll post those in the back, and you can take a look at that after services this evening. So we've covered those things as far as calendars go, but just continue, please keep Jerry in prayer. Bobby's not here this evening, he may be on the live stream, but remember, Bobby has surgery scheduled for June 14th. I know he said Sunday is really giving him some trouble, and that's why he wasn't able to get up and walk up front to the table. So just continue, please keep Bobby in prayer. And then the Hills are not here this evening, but they had made mention of, I believe, a friend of theirs, of Nisa, that's the mother, and for the baby, to be praying for those two. So please keep them in prayer. And then I had an update of Cindy, who is Nancy Ginn's sister, has cancer. So please be praying for her as well. Is there anything else this evening? Mike?
Akeem contacted. He's got a new job. Mm-hmm. That's a restaurant that's opening in June. I'm not sure. He hasn't given me a start date yet, but he's kind of excited. It's a fish food restaurant. He's pretty excited about having a job, I think.
Good. Good. I knew he was supposed to have that training soon, and yeah, it seemed like I saw that. Good. That's good news. Yes, that's why Patty's not here this evening. They had gone to a funeral, so I think the plan is she was here last night for our financial class, and I think she should be here Sunday, but please keep Patty's family in prayer.
I think that's probably not the same calling hours, but Brooke and Janice, or at least Brooke is at calling hours this
okay.
evening. I'm assuming Janice is maybe with her, and that's why neither of them are here, but Brooke had messaged me and said she wasn't going to be here.
Okay. This evening, we ought to be aware of. I should look up at you when I ask questions. Okay, they're going. So right now, she's at home.
I think she.
Okay.
Where she was in, she was in the hospital.
Okay, but they're going to try to get her.
They're trying to get something worked out.
Try for nursing. Okay. Well, thank you. I appreciate that update. Anything else this evening we ought to be aware of? Things that are coming up, we're glad to see. You may notice Jim and Nancy are here this evening. We're glad to see them. And I got to be out in the sun, got to be out in the heat. And so we're glad you're here in person. She said she enjoys the live stream, but nothing like being here in person. And we agree with that. So good to have you here. Anything else before we have an opening word of prayer? If not, again, we appreciate all of those on the live stream that are here for the Bible study. We appreciate all of you here in person. If there's nothing else, if you would at this time stand, we'll have an opening word of prayer. If you will bow with me. Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer. Lord, we have that opportunity as your people to come before you with thankful hearts, with hearts of being able to just count our blessings each day, knowing, Lord, that you are the one who has given those things to us. Lord, that you are the one who has given us eternal life that is beyond here. Lord, that is far greater than here, so may we be able to rejoice in those things. But Lord, we also come to you in prayer tonight because we have brothers and sisters in Christ that are struggling with health. Lord, there are those who are in need of prayer. Lord, there are those who cannot be here tonight, and so we just pray for them and that, Lord, that they might have the opportunity to worship with us again, be with us Sunday, Lord, and that they might be able to live faithful lives to you. Lord, we're Just so thankful that we can come study your word tonight. Help us to grow in our faith. Lord, we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. This evening, we're going to sing the song, Home of the Soul. Home of the Soul. But before we do that, I want to share Romans 8, a few passages from Romans 8. In verse 18, it says this, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." And then verses 23 through 25, it says, "Not only that, but we also who have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, eagerly awaiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. For we were saved in this hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For why does one still hope for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance." So hopefully you and I, as we talk about the home of the souls, talk about heaven, talk about that eternal reward with God, that's what we're dwelling on as we think about this song. But if you are here and you've been struggling to be faithful and you're in need of the prayers of your brothers and sisters in Christ, then why not ask for those prayers tonight as we're singing Home of the Soul?
Spirit of the home, blessed and very sure. finish up chapter 7 in John, and also then get into chapter 8. So I would like to welcome everybody to the class as well, especially those that are on the live feed. We appreciate you coming in, tuning in that way, and look forward to the time when you can be with us in person. In John chapter 8, we've gotten down to the last section. I'm sorry, John chapter 7. We've gotten down to the last section in that chapter. Verses 45 through 53 is where we're planning on starting. And just kind of get our minds kind of pulled back together into this particular area of John's, of the Gospel according to John. You know, Jesus has performed the first recorded miracle that we know. The Bible actually calls it his first miracle. That's the changing the water to wine. And then he healed the nobleman's son. He healed the lame man by the pool, remember? And he fed the 5,000, and he also walked to Peter on the water. So that's kind of a backdrop that will kind of pull ourselves back into this line of thinking as what's going on here and how these people are dealing with that emotional situation for them. In amazement, as they probably, at least I know I would have been amazed to see some of those things happen. How do you explain a basket that just two fish and five loaves of bread, or was it five loaves and two fish? Which way was it? Five loaves and two fish. just in amazement, you know, it keeps coming, keeps coming, keeps coming. Anyway, truly an amazing situation. Let's go now, with that in the backdrop, then let's look at this situation as Jesus is dealing with the Sanhedrin, you know, the Jewish council. That's what the last part of chapter 7 deals with. So, they've seen these things, they've heard about these things, and in verse 45, then John tells us, then the officers came to the chief priests and the Pharisees, who said to them, "Why have you not brought him?" Referring to Christ, of course. I really appreciate the response, and I've heard this used in sermons before. The officers answered, "No man ever spoke like this man." Well, nobody ever did things like this guy did either. So, but he spoke with authority. And it was something that, and kindness. And it was just something that they hadn't seen or heard before. Then verse 47, then the Pharisees answered them, "Are you also deceived?" You know, you see that the bickering back and forth, or the digging in of the heels, so to speak, of the Pharisees at what appears to be, in their minds at least, people accepting Christ. Nobody ever spoke like this guy has. Nobody's ever spoken like Jesus has. Well, are you deceived? Did he trick you some way? That's kind of the attitude that's coming out here. In verse 48, have any of the rulers or the Pharisees believed in him? You know, now there's pride, in my opinion. There's pride coming out. What about those rulers have been with you all this time, the Pharisees? Have any of those people believed in him? You know, especially say, what's wrong with you? Right? What's wrong with you? If anybody's believed in him, well, you know, that was their reaction. And verse 49, but this coward that does not know the law is accused. Well, again, they're making excuses. Maybe they're intimidated. Maybe they're threatened by the presence of Christ and the acceptance that he's receiving here. So, then we see Nicodemus, who came to Jesus' night earlier, remember? He wanted to know more about Christ. So, apparently, Jesus had made an impression upon Nicodemus. And apparently, he had concern for it, maybe his safety, maybe his acceptance, we don't really know. But he came to Jesus by night earlier. We talked about that some weeks ago. Now, what's he do? As this dialogue is happening between the Pharisees and the officers and the rest of the Sanhedrin, apparently. But Nicodemus, in verse 50, stands up for Christ. He says, he who came to Jesus by night, being one of them, said to them, verse 51, does our law judge a man because or before it hears him and knows what he is doing? So I kind of think of Nicodemus here as trying to pull these people back to center. You know, you had the Pharisees clear on the left, so to speak, and just trying to undermine Christ any way they could. And then here's Christ who's on the right, he's telling them about himself, and he's telling about the kingdom. So Nicodemus is trying to pull them together a little bit here. So, well, what about, you know, do we judge a person before we even hear him and know what he's doing? So they answered and said to them, "Are you also a Gentile?" I see here's the rest of the council. You know, are you a Gentile too, or a Galilee too, a Galilean too? Now, why would they make that kind of statement? Are you a Galilean too? Or are you from Galilee?
Because he's standing up for Jesus.
Okay.
He's questioning their method of doing it without giving Jesus a chance to answer anything.
Yes. And then in verse 52, as they continue this conversation in response to Nicodemus' comment, are you also from Galilee? Why would they say that?
Because there's a saying, nothing good at every
Yeah, so are you sticking up for one of your countrymen? Mm-hmm. Now, was Jesus from Galilee?
He wasn't born there.
Wasn't born there.
But he grew up in Nazareth.
So. Okay, okay. Bethlehem is near what famous city? Jerusalem. Yeah. Bethlehem is near Jerusalem in Judea. Down close to the Dead Sea, up in the region of the Sea of Galilee, or that area, of course, is where Nazareth was. I suppose it's still there, I don't know. But you see, again, they're just trying to drive these wedges between accepting Christ and for who he is, and challenging his authority. So, to Nicodemus, are you also from Galilee? Search and look, for no prophet has arisen out of Galilee. You know, can't you just hear that being a snide remark? If any account comes out of Galilee, no prophet ever came from there. So, what happens next? They'll get confused and go away. Right? That's what the verse is about. They don't say anything about being confused, but my thought is that they are. And everyone went to his own house. You know, it's kind of give up, let's go home, let's not talk about this anymore. So they gave up and went home. But this exchange of thoughts here certainly was not in the favor of Christ. So that's what's happened. And his time has not yet come. So these are events that's happening leading up to the time of the cross and the acceptance of Christ by the nations of people, the Gentile people, and the Samaritan lady is looking for their Christ, and the Jewish people is trying to stand their ground and hang on to their heritage. Any questions or comments that we have here? All right. Let's look at chapter 8. This chapter, from the outline that I gave you, the first 11 verses deals with a woman taken in adultery. And then we're going to look at the father's witness. And then the destiny of the disobedient. And then Jesus speaks of the Father. The freedom and sonship is another section, and the last section deals with the Father's honor and the Son. The Father honors the Son. So, I don't know how much time has passed in these events, where the chapter has come to an end of chapter 7 and chapter 8 begins. But Jesus has, the chapter 8 begins by saying that Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Early in the morning, he came again into the temple, and all the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. So, why did he see it as a gathering place.
Yeah.
And Jesus goes there, and I feel certain that he knew that it was a gathering place. And because he was there, people came to see him. So we know that he was gaining momentum, gaining popularity, gaining acceptance, because people wanted to know more about the Messiah. So he sits down and taught them. Then the scribes and the Pharisees brought to him, here we go again, right? Here's a challenge. Here comes the scribes and the Pharisees, verse 3, brought to him a woman caught in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said to him, Teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law, okay, now what law is in effect right now? Right then. The old law is in effect. So now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned, but what do you say? Now, see, there's a verse coming that says they did that to test him. But we know that that the old law was still in existence at this point. Christ had not died on the cross. So it's on the other side of the cross as far as we're concerned. And that was the Old Testament law. So what do you say, knowing that the old law was still in effect? What are you going to do with it? Because you're doing things we really don't know how to handle, such as the healing of that leper or that lame man by the pool, right? You did that on the Sabbath. You told him to take up his bed and walk. That was on the Sabbath. So what do you do with this? Verse 6. This, they said, testing him, that they might have something of which to accuse him. But Jesus, and wouldn't you just really like to know, when he stooped down and wrote on the ground with his finger, as though he did not hear. Wouldn't you really like to know what he was writing with his finger? We don't know. The Bible doesn't say. But just, I've often wondered, what was he writing on the ground? But anyway, verse 7, so when they continued to ask him, because he just kept writing on the ground as if he didn't hear him, so when they continued asking him, he raised himself up and said to them, now look how clever this is, how he gets them right by the throat, so to speak. Okay, who is without sin among you? Let him throw that first stone.
I'd say probably some of those people had done the same thing she had.
It could well be. Then again, he stoops down, verse 8, and writes on the ground. So, yeah, some of those people that brought her in to that situation could well have been that way, could well have done the same thing.
Plus, they were not actually following the old law, because in Deuteronomy, they were to bring both people, not just the woman. So they were only doing it not to punish the people for the adultery, but simply to try to trick Jesus.
Yes. And the verse says that, right? Verse 6, they said this testing him. So no wonder Christ called him hypocrites at times. But anyway, so verse 9 says, then those who heard being convicted by their conscience, like Linda was saying, okay, I can't throw that first rock. I may not have been an adulterer, but he didn't say that, even though some of them may well have been. He didn't say that he is without the first sin. You know, let him throw the first stone. Boy, what's that old saying about if you live in glass houses, you shouldn't throw rocks? Convicted by their conscience, went out one by one, beginning with the oldest even to the last. And Jesus was left alone. And the woman standing in the midst. So, here we go. What does Jesus do with her? When Jesus had raised himself up and saw no one but the woman, he said to her, Woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you? She said, No one, Lord. Jesus said to her, neither do I condemn you, go and sin no more. There's a lesson right there for us about that be adultery. It can be any type of sin. Go and sin no more. No more. He didn't categorize the nature of the sin. It's go and sin no more. And I am so thankful that we read about people like Simon the Sorcerer in the New Testament. Young Christian made a mistake, and he was making his living tricking people, right? That's what he was doing. And then he ran into people that were following after Christ, and they converted him, and then he saw the works of the Holy Spirit, and he wasn't tagged to do those type of things, and tried to buy that, and said, man, no, that's not your position. Pray to God, your heart's not right. And that's the lesson for us. Boy, it would be so easy for a new Christian just to be able to flush out all the desires, all the things that causes problems as they come out of the waters of baptism, just to flush out all those things, those temptations from their lives. They can't do that. None of us could. So we struggle. We work through some things. We learn, and we try to do better. We pray for forgiveness. Go and sin no more. Then she comes in contact with Christ. And from going from that low point of being, you're probably not going to live through the day, to the point of being in contact with Christ and being forgiven of sins. Go and sin no more. You can't help but to wonder, like you say, Scott, how many people that she told about that experience, as anyone would. I mean, you're in a really bad situation here, and these lawgivers that we've known has been around all of our lives, the Pharisees. They caught me in something I shouldn't have been doing. They were dragging me off, and I was just convinced they were going to stone me. And then I managed to find Christ. And through his forgiveness, I have a new life. How does that relate to us? Sin separates us from God, right? Isaiah 59, 1 and 2 talks about that. And Ephesians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13 talks about that. About being separated from Christ and being drawn into or drawn near by the blood of Christ, verse 13 of Ephesians 2. And the appreciation that we should have certainly excels and should motivate us to tell somebody else about the good news of Christ. Hey, I met Christ, and guess what? Our experience certainly wasn't like this woman here, to meet in person. But we meet Christ in Scripture, right? Through faith, we meet Christ in Scripture. scriptures call us, according to the Thessalonian letter. So we come to Christ, and all those things that might have been cluttering our lives before, that guilt of those things are now gone, because Christ said, do this, and we did this, and your sins are forgiven. Go and sin no more. Wash away your sins. When we look at the examples of people doing that in New Testament time, it was through the act of faith which led them to be baptized, to be, have their sins washed away. Just like Paul was told, Saul at the time, in Acts 22:16, when he had come in contact with Christ earlier on the road to Damascus, and then as he's sent to Ananias, can you imagine the anticipation of Ananias? Hey, Lord, are you sure? I've heard of this guy before. Are you really sure you're going to talk to him? Go. Ananias says, after Paul had been praying, and he says, that's not getting the job done. Get up. Wash away your sins. Be baptized. Wash away your sins. Start that new life. You can't help but to wonder about this lady as what might have happened to her later on in life. We're not told. But when people come in contact with Christ and truly accept him, lives change. Anything else that anybody wants to add to these first 11 verses? Situation like that.
Some of the people that were in on that plot should have realized that he was outsmarting them and had more knowledge than what they had any way to be in possession of.
Yeah. I hadn't really thought about that, but you're absolutely right. So, anything else? All right. The next section goes from verses 12 through 20, and Jesus begins to teach these Pharisees, and there's a significance here that I really want to focus on. You'll see that under item 2A, and we'll get to that in just a moment. But in verse 12, then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, now who's he talking to? He's talking to the Pharisees. I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have life, the light of life. The Pharisees therefore said to him, you bear witness of yourself. Your witness is not true. Now, they're having a real difficult time here, because how are these people thinking in terms of confronting Christ? They're thinking in terms of being human, in terms of laws being written, of human reactions, of the Messiah not being there yet. And it's not miraculous. They're trying to deal with black and white. And Jesus expands their knowledge here, whether they want to accept it or not. Verse 14, Jesus answered and said to them, even if I bear witness of myself, my witness is true. For I know where I came from and where I'm going, but you do not know where I came from and where I'm going. You judge according to the flesh. That's the point I was trying to make there about the little explanation. You judge according to the flesh. You're looking at the black and white. I'm trying to tell you about something that's beyond that. Then, the latter part of that verse 15, he says, I judge not. I judge no one. And yet, if I do judge, my judgment is true, for I am not alone, but I am with the Father who sent me. So a couple of things that I want to mention before we get into this comparison that I asked you to look at. He's talking about the unity that's within him and the Father. In other places he said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He told Philip, how long have you been with me? And you asked me about the Father. You've seen me, you've seen the Father, because we are one. We are consistent. system. We think alike, we act like we are united that way. John 17, Jesus prays for unity, the opening part of that chapter, right? But what I want to ask you is in verse 15, he says, I judge no one. Why would he say that? And let's keep it in context here. What was he saying? I judge no one. Okay,
he's
not
a teacher. He sent us a teacher. That's his goal now. And that's on out the, like, you don't want to add more to confuse things. So his main focus is teaching.
Okay.
At that time.
Okay.
And
good
then
point.
Down the road, it kind of develops. Down the road, he just gives them, he's just trying to give them what they can understand in small bits.
Yeah. I think you're spot on. It's interesting as people today look at Scripture and they say that we're not to judge. Well, we're not to judge in the sense that Christ will judge. But you make judgment calls every day of your life, whether you like it or not. You judge whether you're going to get out of bed or not. You judge what clothes you're going to wear. You judge what you're going to say. You decide what you're going to say. His time hadn't come yet. Someone go to John chapter 17. I'm sorry, John chapter 12, verse 48. John chapter 12, verse 48. I'd like for you to read that verse for us. The stage is being set here as he deals with these people and trying to get them to understand who they are, who he is, and the fact that the law is changing. The direction of God is changing. The Old Testament law is being fulfilled in him. And he's trying to get them to understand that. But he says, the word I've spoken will judge you in the last day. Jesus will judge. No question about that.
Well, I think another thing he's trying to get them to understand is I'm not doing it like you expect me to. You know,
yep.
You judge, I mean, in verse 15, you judge according to the flesh, you know. And, of course, he's not saying, the rest of that verse is I'm not judging anyone, but it's like, even if I were judging someone, I wouldn't be doing it the way you're doing it.
That's right.
I do it God's way, you know.
Yep.
Just, yeah.
And okay. Just, go ahead.
I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
You have to think, too, of where the Pharisees are coming from. They pulled themselves up as the teachers.
Mm-hmm.
They hold themselves up as being the ones that are giving the information. They are not in the mood to accept.
And they want to be recognized as such, too. You know, they want that recognition that they are the authority, that they are the interpreter of the law. But that attitude got them in trouble. And the reference I left for you is in John or Matthew 23. Starts in verse 1, but that's the chapter where Jesus pronounced woes upon them 8 times. He says, woe unto you. And it's because of this attitude that they had of, in Matthew 23, verse 5, let's get verse 4, too. For they bind every heavy burdens, heavy to bear, hard to bear, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. But all their works they do to be seen by men, that they make their phylacteries broader and enlarge their borders of their garments. Pharisees, you know, so they'd be recognized as they were walking around. Hey, look, here comes one of those religious guys that has this authority of the old law. And they wanted that recognition. And that's what Jesus was pronouncing as a woe unto them for their actions. But Sue's right here. You know, these guys were looking to the immediate and not the transition, and not the fact that they needed to accept Christ for who he is. Verse 17, it's also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. I am one who bears witness of myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness of me. Now, here's something they have a hard time grasping, because they just don't get this idea of Christ as who he really and truly is. Then they said to him, where is your Father? Jesus answered, you know neither me nor my Father. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. These words Jesus spoke in the treasury as he taught in the temple, and no one laid hands on him, for his hour had not yet come. I see this teaching of Christ being in kind of bits and segments, to where that you give them this little bit, and then maybe they'll grasp it, maybe they won't, but here, try this on for size. And then moves on and tries again. Any comments about those verses 12 through 20? Pharisee, you're looking at your standards, at your direction, but I got something better. I got something much better. And you're just not getting it here. But eventually, I think they do. At least some of them did. So, the subject changes here, and the tone changes a bit because of the reactions of the I think of the Pharisees here, but look at verse 21 through 24. Then Jesus said to them again, I am going away, and you will seek me, and you will die in your sin. Where I go, you cannot come. So the Jews said, will he kill himself because he says, where I go, you can't come? See, they're still confused. They don't know. And they're just trying to grasp this, but they just don't know. And he said to them, verse 23, you are from beneath, I am from above. You are of this world, and I am not of this world. Therefore, I said to you that you will die in your sins, for if you do not believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. Yeah. He's the way, the truth, and the life. We will die in our sins if we don't believe in him. There's no substitute. There's no other way. Jesus is the way. Thoughts on that? Anybody?
Well, I mean, just you're talking about Isaiah 59. If you have a passage that talk about sin separates you from God, even what Jesus is saying is, by them dying in their sins, they wouldn't be with him or the Father. They wouldn't be with God.
Yeah. Sometimes I'm just so baffled about why there's so much division in the world over so straightforward a doctrine here, as to accepting Christ for who he is. So in verse 25 through 30, then Jesus kind of shifts gears on and speaks about of God the Father. And again, trying to build and trying to teach these people who he really is. Verse 25, then they said to him, who are you? And Jesus said to them, just what I have been saying to you from the beginning. I have many things to say and to judge concerning you, but he who sent me is true, and I speak to the world those things which I heard from him. There's that unity again he's talking about between Christ and the Father. They didn't understand that, verse 27. He spoke to them of the Father. Jesus said to them, when you lift up the Son of Man, okay, what's he referring to? Yeah, he's talking about enough, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself. But as my Father taught me, I speak these things. And he who sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I always do those things that pleases him. So if you're not keying in on what you're saying, when Christ's on the cross, one of the things he said is, Father, why have you forsaken me? And yet this verse says, never left him alone. So how do we sync those verses together? I'm not sure I can answer that. I've heard people talk about, well, Christ was carrying the weight of sin of the world, of all the generations of sin, on him at the crucifixion. And the Father can't look on sin like that. And that by Christ bearing the sins of the world, that load of the sins, and the load of that sin, knowing that that separates us from God, understanding of separation from the Father. Christ appreciates that and understands that. Christ is also human at that point, even though he was divine. Even though he was divinity, he was still human. And I can't imagine the death on the cross, any cross. I can't imagine being nailed to the cross. Could you bear watching the video that Scott showed here a couple Sundays ago, the sounds of the cross? Remember that video? That's a powerful, powerful video. I'd ask Scott to show that sometime because it's just so moving. You don't really see anything, but you get the side effects of it and the sounds of it. Christ being crucified. Christ was still human. And I think that it's consistent for him to say that overall, I know I'm not separated from the Father. He's always with me. The things I do to please him. But yet bearing the sins of the world and understanding that separation helps us, gives us assurance that Christ understands where we are. When sin separates us from God and we go to Christ go to God the Father in petition of prayer and say, help me to overcome this sin. And the Holy Spirit interpolates that, translates that, that understanding of that separation that we feel because our conscience has pulled us away. Our seasoned conscience by the Scripture has told us that we've sinned and that separates us from God. And we don't like that separation. I don't know if that syncs with what you had in mind or not, but that's kind of the way I looked at it.
Well, you know, we know Jesus going to the cross was not of his own will, but of the will of the Father. So by him doing such, he was obeying the Father. He was doing what the Father had asked of him. You know, had Jesus not gone to the cross, had Jesus done his sin on his own, but he took on the sin of the world, that was from the beginning. God had that plan before Christ was ever born into the world.
Yep.
That was the plan. He knew my son would come, and he would bear that weight so that he might be able to come back and be with me to have the glory, and that others might be saved and be united with me. So it's not as if, like, when we sin, we go against God. Jesus did the very thing God asked him to do, to die on the cross.
And he knew the end result.
Yeah.
And I think that syncs these verses together. We're almost out of time. We'll start with verse 31 next time, but I want you to, if folks at home, if you have a pen and paper handy, I'd like you to make note of this verse 31, because it tells us what it means to be a disciple of his. And we're going to link up two other verses with this verse. But verse 31 says, Jesus said to those Jews who believed him, those Jews who believed him. Catch that, because some of those Jews believed him. If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. If you abide in my word. So if we abide in Christ's word today, we are his disciples indeed. Now if you go over to John 13, verses 34 and 35, a couple other verses here I want to tie in with this one. John 13, verses 34 and 35. A new commandment I gave to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this all will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. So abide in his word, you're his disciples. Love one another, you're his disciples. John 15, verse 8. Verse 7 and 8. If you abide in me and my word abides in you, you will ask what you desire, and I shall be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples. Abide in his word, love the church, bear fruit. All those are evidences of being a disciple of Christ. I want to be a disciple of Christ. How about you? Well, we're out of time. The Lord willing, we'll start with verse 31 next week. Would you bow with me in a word of prayer, please? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the blessings you give us. We thank you for your word. Ask you to help us to learn your word and to modify our lives, make changes where we need to, draw closer to you, and resist the devil. Through your Son's name we pray. Amen.